God, Heavenly Father, we just thank you and magnify you and glorify you, Lord. And God, Heavenly Father, I'm not the only one praying this morning. We're praying together, God, coming together as one. That, dear God, to the only one that can do anything about it. God, we're not praying, dear God, to Grandma or Grandpa, God. We're not praying, Lord, dear God, just to get something off our chest. But God, we are calling out to the one and only, the one who all power has been given unto him in heaven and in earth. And God, we believe right now that Jesus Christ is at the right hand making intercession for us, which means that we know we have access to the throne. And God, we come boldly, and God, we come humbly also, God, because we are so unworthy, God, of everything that you do for us. But God, that makes us all the more thankful, God, for how you move in our lives, and God, how that you are uniquely creating possibilities for us, God, and our own situations. You're able, God, and you work all things together for our good. And we believe that, Father, right now. Lord, move today, God, in our Sunday school lesson. Move, dear God, in the needs of your people, God. I pray, Lord, that you just touch every broken heart, mend them and bind them together, God, that they may be, dear God, in perfect peace. Lord, we believe, dear God, that your peace is the peace that passeth all understanding. We give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praise. Thank you for your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. We're going to try to finish out James chapter 5 this morning and give everybody a chance to get there. To be honest, I think we've made it through James faster than I thought we would. It seems like we were just in Hebrews. But you say, Brother Josh, there's only 5 chapters. Well, that ought to be good for about 5 months, right? But anyway, here we are. And we talked about patience last week and kind of did get through that entire passage. But it's interesting. Sometimes we're patient in categories that don't really seem to matter. And then sometimes we don't have patience for things that really, really need patience, right? You know, every one of us have our own set of triggers, right? Just things that kind of irk us or aggravate us or bother us. And I just want to share something, not to build up the enemy of your soul this morning, but to make you aware. If we were playing football against the enemy, or against an opposing team, rather, we would like to study their strategy, and we'd like to study their strengths and their weaknesses. Well, there's no difference this morning in the battle for your soul. The enemy has studied you. He knows your strengths. He knows your weaknesses. He knows what gets you up. He knows what gets you down. And he'll use every dirty trick in the bag to come against you. I'm just telling you. I'm just making you forewarned, right? But I'm telling you this right now. Through God's patience, you can endure the fight. Amen? You can endure the fight. And they say like this in boxing, roll with the punches. Punches are going to come. Jabs are going to come. The haymakers are going to come. The uppercuts are going to come. You got to guard yourself. You got to protect yourself. But you've got to roll with the punches. You can't just sit there and take it. And you've got to have some foot strategy. Amen? Where is your footing this morning, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. You know, every one of us can try to prove to the world that we can take one good on the chin, right? But the thing is, that's not how the devil fights. The devil doesn't try to hit you one time and then he's done for. He's going to do an onslaught. He's going to come at you from all directions. But thank God this morning that God's always with us. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you, but I will with you all the way, even unto the ends of the world. And if you're still here, then it's not the end just yet. Amen? And so even to the end, he's going to be there, and he's faithful. And so our faith is tested. Tested. It really is. Anybody in here ever come through a test? And just naturally speaking, maybe for school or for work or whatever it may be, and you failed it, thought you really knew the answers, thought you really knew what to do, and you find out that you didn't have the knowledge or you didn't have the remembrance of what it was that it took to do it. I find out every day that I could be a better Christian tomorrow.
Amen.
I find out every day. that there's some spots that I need God to come in, and I'm not a welder this morning, but if I imagine my life as a piece of metal this morning, God's always got the helmet down. He's always trying to fix it, right? He's always trying to work on it. And I like what Pastor said the other day. He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. And the thing is, the problem is sometimes we really think we're a little farther along than what we are until we are tested. Until we are tried. I mean, we don't get real just a minute. You know, none of us in here set out to get aggravated. We've been watching, and you can laugh at me if you want to, but been watching Steve Urkel a lot lately at the house, and there ain't hardly anything clean to watch on TV, so make fun of me all you want, right? It's better than what some of other folks want to watch. But anyway, there's an episode, Carl Winslow, he gets aggravated every time Steve comes over to the house, right? I mean, it's just like, I don't know why they don't just pick up and move, but Steve would find them, right? Because he's so in love with Laura, right? Anyway, you can just tell that's the kids. Even, you know, they did not grow up in the 90s, but I love it because they're like, Dad, can we watch Steve Urkel tonight? And I'm like, man, this is just a dream come true. This is the good stuff, right? But anyway, going back, there's this episode where Carl realizes, or that gets brought to his attention, that he really needs to get a check on getting so frustrated that it's affecting his health. He's gonna have a heart attack. And so he goes to the heart doctor, and when he gets there, he didn't stay long enough for the visit, Brother Larry. He read a brochure in the lobby or right there in the waiting room that just kind of said, you know, here's a technique. If you get in a struggle, Chris, just count 1, 2, 3. And it had some kind of saying, you know. And anyway, he didn't go on to see the doctor. He just got that brochure and said, well, I think this is enough. And he went on. And at the end of the episode, we find out that, you know, he didn't see the doctor. He tried this little rinky-dink process. It didn't fulfill what needed to be fulfilled, and so he even blew a greater head gasket, and he realized that he really should have been seen. He really should have done it the right way. And I'm just saying that to say this morning. If we don't have patience and endure the trials and the processes that we face, and we try to find a gimmick, just something that we think will work, if we try to find something that you know, I see people, and I, you know, I'm not pointing at them or whatever, but you know, they'll you watch television, the cartoons, you know, they'll do their Hail Mary, you know. I face life a lot like that. We think that if we just Lord, thank you, Jesus, help me, you know, that's enough for a prayer life, and that's not enough. We think if we quote John 3:16 enough times, then we've got what it takes, and we're just scratching the surface. God does not want you to have some, you know, scripture out of context to connect with Him, or just some hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, and it's all going to work. You can praise God. I'm not saying that praise is not a weapon, but what I'm telling you today is there has to be a more deep, enduring relationship with God than just, you know, just coming to church is not enough. I mean, just saying a prayer every once in a while is not enough. Not, you know, just cracking the Bible, you know, open every once in a while is not enough. They're really, truly, when he talks about patience and affliction, sometimes we are going to be afflicted. I wish that was not the case. I really wish that I could preach to you today that once you get an affliction, here's this special brochure that we just printed off the press. We found that this works. And if you'll just count to three and just act like it doesn't exist, then everything's going to be okay. How many know that does not work? It's like my sister. She's got 5 children, and I don't know how she does it. I'll be honest with you. But you know what? I'll call her, and she's picking up this mess, and she's cleaning up this other one, and she's fighting after that one, and she's chasing. And I told her Friday, I said, no matter how much stress I endure at work, you got me beat. We're not trading spots. I could not do your job. It's just the truth. I can't do it. But no matter how aggravating it gets, there is no close your eyes, count to three, open your eyes, and the kids just magically doing what they're supposed to be doing, and there'll be no problems, or close your eyes and the kids are gone. That doesn't happen either. Come on. Hello. What I'm trying to say is sometimes we have things in our life and they help prepare us for bigger troubles down the road. And it's almost like if we look at it lopsided, how many believe the Bible when he says he takes us from glory to glory? That means mountaintop experience to mountaintop experience. That means that we see what God done here and we can take it on into the next battle and we can just demonstrate and testify of what God done on the next circuit, right? But what I'm telling you is this valley is preparing you for tomorrow's valley. It's all comprehensive, right? Nothing that you and I face in this life is happenstance or accidental or, now don't get me wrong. We have a part in the matter. You and I this morning have free will. We get to make our own choices. I'll be honest with you. In my prayer life, I'd like to say, God, just make me a robot. Just program me that I'll do the right thing every time. And then, guess what? Even if you did the right thing every time, that still doesn't mean that you could forego affliction. Why do I believe that? Because the Bible says, many are the afflictions of the righteous. Right? So if I break that down, that means that if I'm righteous, then I'm doing what's right. I'm doing what's right. I've got a clean slate with God. Things are good, right? Well, why would somebody that's doing good and doing all they know to do, why would they be afflicted? Because the Bible said that we will be. He said, many are the afflictions of the righteous. But, don't you like that there's a but? Usually I don't want to hear but. But when it's bad news, I got to hear a but because there's got to be something better than that. But the Lord delivereth them out of them all. Anybody in here this morning ever been in a trial God couldn't correct? God couldn't fix? God couldn't show you? Something through that there was, even if it was a painful experience, it was a learning experience. It was something beneficial that God gave to you, even though I know sometimes we would like to think we know best, right? God, I don't know if I like what I shared with a friend. We were talking the other day, and we were talking about just different trials in life. And man, this sounds real doom and gloom, doesn't it? I don't know if you had breakfast this morning. You might have had your favorite breakfast. Come to Sunday school and hear about afflictions. Hear about troubles. Hear about trials. Hear about tests. But anyway, I sent this to him because a friend of mine had sent it to me. And I thought it was really, really good. Some of the stuff you're going through is taking you to the place you asked God to take you. You just don't like how you're getting there. Come on. Said, but just because you're used to being disappointed, don't give up on God. He won't let you down. You see, it's easy to play the blame game toward God if you would have been, right? You remember when Lazarus died and Martha came out and said, if you would have just been here, we called for you and you didn't come immediately. You know, and in our minds, you know, if we wanted to play Martha this morning, we would say, Lord, they really did call you. You know, you could have prevented that. I mean, really, just realistically thinking, does anybody in here doubt the fact that the Lord could have stopped Lazarus from dying? I believe He could have. I know He could have. But still yet, He had a better plan. Still yet, he knew what he needed to do. And still yet, God worked it out the way it needed to happen. Sometimes we fight with how it's coming about. Right? I'll flip the script on you. Some of us this morning, and I'm not being political, and I'm not giving any of that down the road. I'm just saying, some of us may or may not have been disappointed with an election that took place last year. Some of us may or may not be disappointed with local government, state government, things that come out on an everyday basis. Doesn't it seem like you're just kind of waiting for what's next? I don't know about you, but there's an unsettling in my spirit, in my soul, that I just really don't know what's going on. I do, spiritually, I know where it's leading us. I know where it's taking us, right? I know that there has to be these times of troubles and turmoil and problems in order for there to be the Lord to come back. Amen? I believe the rapture is about to take place. And I believe that's what I'm looking for. Amen. I'm looking up because the Bible says your redemption draweth nigh. It's coming. Amen. Even at the door. Jesus is about to come back. My God. Could we face anything else? It seems like sometimes. I don't ever want to be the one that says, well, nothing else worse than that. Anything else can happen, right? There's all kinds of things that can happen, and sometimes these things come out of the way. But what does the Word of God say? I'm going to go back. I'm going to overlap. Verse number 8 said, "Be ye also patient, establish your hearts." You see, we talk about having a mind made up, and I believe that that's important because the Bible says a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. You ever been around somebody that was indecisive? Maybe that's you. You know, maybe that's me. Maybe we all can be indecisive depending on what it is, right? It's really, I'll throw this in for good measure. If I get in trouble later, I won't tell you. But, you know, it's amazing when you're going down the road and you're with, don't nobody look over at your spouse this morning, right? You say, well, what do you want to eat? Just let me tell you guys, that is a trick question. All, your best answer in that scenario is, I just like to eat. I don't care where we eat. It doesn't matter, right? Because I got to tell this, and I almost hate that Brother Davis was recording this morning. My dad would kill me. But he don't get on Facebook that much anyway, so don't tell him. But I'll never forget, we left church, Sunday school one morning, and we was going out to eat. This has been 25 years ago. And Mom and Dad, I don't know what they was spatting over, but and they've been married, this December will make 36 years. Amen. And they got married at 18 years old. They had to wait for my dad to turn 18. I think that's funny too. But anyway, they got married. They, you know, have six children and multitude of grandchildren, and we're just repopulating pigskin every which way we know how. But anyway, they was arguing about something. I don't know what it was. And my dad said, "I'll just have you know." He said, "I'm the head of this house." And then he said, "Where are we eating?" And so that kind of dissipated the argument, you know. Yeah, okay. But anyway, I'm saying this, we're indecisive. We're unsettled. We don't know what to do, how to do, when to do, and we're unstable when we don't have our mind right. That's a given, right? But where are we at when we don't have our heart right is what I'm trying to get at this morning. You see, your mind, it is not going to amount to a hill of beans unless you get a hill of beans for lunch. But it's not going to matter too much on where you choose to eat after Sunday school today. I mean, there are some restaurants that might give you a little more indigestion than others, right? Or if you go home to cook, just be careful cutting up the veggies, right? With your knife. You know, I'm not saying that it doesn't matter. I'm just saying it's really insignificant in the grand scheme of things. But where your heart lies, the Bible says that out of your heart come the issues of life. You see, you and I, we have to establish our hearts. You know, the enemy is attacking in every way that he can, and if he can attack and get your heart to change, right? You know, it's easy when we get frustrated and aggravated. Has anybody, and I'm not looking even at you this morning, but has anybody ever got so frustrated at so many things coming and going that you say, I'm sick and tired of people? Come on. Yeah, hello. And then we come to church on Sunday morning and we say, God bless you, I love you, it's so good to see you. Oh man. And then we tell people, make people feel welcome. And we put that smile on and we're like, it's so good to see you. It's just, you know, but then on Saturday night we're like, I really want to just go off somewhere by myself. Because, you know, if I didn't have to deal with people, then I wouldn't have problems. Well, guess what? I hate to let the cat out of the bag. You are people too.
Amen.
And if you look in the mirror, a lot of your own problems that you have with other people is really something that's not right in you. That hurts. I don't feel, you know, anybody in here ever, you know, it's their fault. It's easy to play the blame game. But we need to put it where it needs to be. He said, establish your hearts. What did he say? For the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. Now how much more fitting would this verse be than here, August 22nd, 2021, when this passage of Scripture was written in 64 A.D. And he was telling them then, look up, Jesus is about to come back get us. Now, we can be like, and I've had people tell me, I've heard that all my life, and it ain't happened yet. Well, it sounds like to me, without being judgmental, there's been a de-establishment of their heart. There's been some unsettledness in their heart. I don't know about you, but I don't care what the devil's throwing our way, I'm going to make it settled right here. Jesus is coming back. Jesus is who He said He is. Jesus will do what He said He will do. The Word of God is still true. Amen. God is still on the throne. Amen. God is still able to work and to move and to come when I need Him. Amen. He's still my high tower and I run into Him. In verse number 9 it says, grudge not one against another, brethren, lest ye be condemned. This word grudge, in my Bible, translates out to grumble. There's a song, it says, teach me not to grumble and complain. Right? It goes on to say, I'm drinking from my saucer, Lord, because my cup has overflowed. You see, when you focus on the blessings that God's given you, it's really hard to complain and grumble about what you don't have. Right? When you focus on how good God is and what He does, and if you count your blessings and begin to name them, and you begin to speak, it's more than just positive faith. You see, the world, they've got a facade, a fake, plastic version of this, and it's just think positively. Just think positively. Now, I don't know about you, I try to be upbeat and positive, and sometimes, as a preacher preached a while back, I heard one of the greatest messages I'd heard in a long time. But we were visiting church, they were revival, and he preached about the fly getting in the apothecary. I get the fly in my ointment sometimes. And I'm not so upbeat, even though that's where I like to stay. But I find that I can't always stay there, Beverly. Sometimes there's just that little thing that's just, it tips the balance, right? There's that little straw that breaks the camel's back and it's like, I've had enough. I'm not doing this. Okay? Well, I understand we cannot always be positive thinking. Sometimes it is what it is. Whatever you are going through, whatever you're facing, the affliction at hand, it's real, it's legitimate. It's not to be dismissed. It's to be taken just for what it is. And how many know this morning that there are these issues and these things that come up and things in life that they can become really heavy? You know, the Bible teaches us to bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ, which means if you really want to live out Christ in your life, you'll start picking up other people's burdens. Sometimes, Brian, the only way that I know to do that is I toss you some of mine. Because I think, man, I've got too much of my own to deal with, right? But really and truly, when we begin to not just look at what we're facing and we see what other people are facing, that's when we can be effective for the kingdom of God. Every one of us live in our own bubble. Every one of us have our own address. Every one of us go to our own place of business, work. We all have our own lives. I guarantee that there's probably many of you this morning, probably 85% of you travel the same road to work every day. You might even have your own routine, and it might be down pat what you do. And we focus a lot. We have to be busy about the things that we've got. The Bible teaches us that if we don't take care of our own, then we are worse than an infidel. We've denied the faith. So I'm not saying neglect your own responsibilities. But what I'm telling you is that you just never know what somebody else is going through. You just never know what's on their plate. And so we have to be patient. We have to establish in our own heart that the Lord is coming back. And so being mindful that we are really at the very cusp of Jesus Christ coming back. How ought I to live? How ought I to think about what's going on in the world? I definitely have no time to grudge one against another. I have no time to grumble and complain about you or about others. I don't need to do that. He said, "Behold, the judge standeth before the door." God hears every idle word. And the Bible says that every idle word, some of us use more words than others. Quit looking at me like that. I know I probably use more words than you. I talk a lot. I'm telling you. I'm finding out, Brother Gary, the older I get, sometimes it's more beneficial to listen than to say something that you ought not say, that you have to go back and say, "I'm sorry." Amen. You know, there's sometimes we say things, and it may not mean as much to us. You know, it might be lighthearted and whatever, but it can really wreck somebody else's world. And I'm not talking about people being easily offended. I'm just saying we should be careful not to offend. The Bible teaches us also that offenses must come. They come. But He also said, "Woe unto them from whence they come." Right? He goes on, He says, "Take my brethren, the prophets, who have spoken in the name of the Lord, for an example of suffering, affliction, and of patience." He says, "I set out folks to go and tell what I wanted to be told. They did just that, and look how they were treated. They told what I wanted to say. They answered the call. They spoke when I said to speak. They said what I wanted to say. And guess what? Here they are being afflicted also." You see, we like to sometimes, anybody in here have those kind of conversations with God? "God, I did everything you told me to do. Shouldn't there be like a bubble around me, a protection around me to not have to face this, that, or the other?" Can I just say this morning, nobody's exempt. Nobody. Troubles of this life are coming, right? But the Lord, He is the one who stands by the door, not only judging those things that should not be, but He is a judge of those things that should be. He's seeing when we get it right also. He's making note of when we endure affliction and we are able to come through. Look at verse number 11. He said, "Behold, we count them happy which endure." Maybe not so much while they endure, but when they get through it. Amen? Anybody in here ever gave up too early? Raise both my hands. Anybody in here ever got through something and then on the other side you begin to see God's provision and God's blessing and God's move and you're like, man alive, I'm glad I held on.
Amen.
I'm glad He held on to me. Amen.
Amen.
You see, you're happy that God allowed you to endure that issue, that problem, that trial, because through that, God taught you, built you, made you into who you needed to be. Sometimes we don't like how God chooses to mold us and to make us what we ought to be. But nonetheless, God cares too much about your character and about your integrity and your demonstration of Him to the world than to just let you anything goes. Amen? He said, behold, we count them happy which endure. Ye have heard of the patience of Job, the perseverance of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord. That the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. You remember all the things that Job went through? For time's sake, we won't get into all of that, but the loss of children, the loss of wealth, the loss of cattle. Now, it's easier for you and I to say, well, we don't know what that's like because we're not raising cattle. But let me just put it like this. That was his livelihood. We do know what it's like to be employed. We do know what it's like to have job loss and job change and transition and things like that. It affected his being able to pay the bills, right? It affected him being able to eat, right? I know he didn't have an electric bill. Come on. I know it's not the same in that regard, but it affected him to not be able to do what he needed to do. So we understand that. But watch what happened real quickly, then I'm going to come to a close. God shows up and begins to bless Job because Job maintained his integrity with God. God began to show up and show out Job's life. Can I just say it like this? Maybe none of us in this room today would ever face the trials and the afflictions to the degree that Job did, but some of us maybe could relate in some sense, right? But can I just say it like this? Every one of us will have to endure this four-letter word. Pastor says that work is a bad word, right? But life can sometimes not be what you planned for it to be. And so, at the end of verse 11, it says, watch what the Lord did at the end of this. Can I just tell you this morning, before we get ready for morning worship, that at the end of all of this, the trials, the circumstances, the troubles, the problems, the things that you and I face, that the end of it is a God that's full of tender compassion and mercy. Amen?
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you something. There will be a warm embrace for those that endure unto the same shall be saved, those that endure to the end. Are you holding on this morning?
Yeah.
Are you thankful He's holding on to you?
Yeah.
Amen. He's going to demonstrate His tender compassion and mercy at the end of this thing, and you'll be glad for every time your soul held on. Amen. Heaven will be worth the journey. Amen. We'll pick up right back there, Brother Robert. Yes, sir. Yeah. That's it.
Not waiting
long
to
see the disciples.
That's it.
That's right.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
All right, good to see you, man. Good morning.
thankful for life and health, you know, the ability to be able to be here this morning. I know a lot of times, and I say that a lot of times whenever I get up here, but, you know, it's sometimes it's the small things that we can overlook, you know, so we need to be thankful for each and every little thing that the Lord gives us. And, you know, I'm just excited about, you know, about the future, you know, what's going on here at the church, you know, and I'm standing back there and I'm looking around. You know, noticing people that's coming through the door and seeing faces that I've never seen, seeing people that I don't know. I mean, I've seen people here for 5 years probably now, and I still don't know your name, but I love you. Yeah. You know, but I do that at work, too. I've worked with some 15 years over there, and I still don't know their name, so I just call them dude. You know, there's a lot of dudes over there. But I'm just excited about it. You know, when I was looking at people, and it was refreshing, and you know, it kept coming to me when I was watching as people was coming in, and I would see faces, you know, and you know, we're working on, you know, breaking ground and building this new church, and I was thinking about, you know what the Lord has done, you know, and what the Lord's doing here, you know, and seeing the things that have been developing. You know, and when I was looking around, I thought, well, I'm seeing what the Lord is doing with some of the youth. I walk in the door. First thing, I walk in the door this morning, you know, and the basement's full of kids. It's full of youth. And I'm thinking, you know, and then I heard somebody say that they had overgrown the Sunday school class up here. Well, that's a wonderful thing, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, look what God said. The kids are here, you know, and they got so big they had to move downstairs. And when I seen it, I thought, you know, a third one, you know, I think about, you know, Brother Nate, you know, I was thinking about him last night. I thought, you know, the Lord is here. I'm gonna give this young man the fruit. And I was thinking about another one. I thought, here's this young man. I'm going to give him the desire to teach some of these young kids and help them out. And I thought, I'm going to send you some others. I'm going to send you some others to help out from another church that's going to come over, that's going to give you a hand, that's going to help out. And it's not about us. It's not about any one of us. It's not about any individual here. It's all about the Lord. What we're doing.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Testimonies that are coming, the people that are wanting to help out, the people that are wanting to do things, you know, and then right here's another. I'm going to send this guy over here, and he's going to play, and he's going to do a little singing with you. I mean, we're thankful to have Daniel. When I look around, I'm just seeing what the Lord is doing. And then today we got Miss Allison with us, you know, I mean, it's all great and everything, and then he says, I'm going to drop this blonde-headed girl right here in the middle of it. It might be black next week, who knows? But it's still Alice, you know, so we're thankful to have her with us here this morning. I know she has decided to, and I will cut her no slack.
That's right.
But just thankful. I mean, you know, when I look, I think, man, just look what the Lord is doing. You know, but it's and we don't want to slow this train down. We want to keep going. I mean, hey, let's just keep moving it right on up. You know, and as it always keeps building, it's helping those that are out here in the community. It's helping those that don't know. You know, because basically somebody's going to look and say, they've got something that I want.
Yes, yes.
Amen. They've got some happiness in their heart, or they're in their life. They just look like they're joy.
Amen.
You know, I want to go get a little taste of that, you know, and then they make it. And, you know, when I look around, I just see other people, players, singers, you know, that are just, you know, and it's just wonderful to see what the Lord's doing here, you know. So we want to give him all the praise and all the glory for it, you know, and we thank him so much for just everything he does for you. All the small things here. All the small things.
Amen.
And so a couple of announcements here, and I'll get out of the way. We got the men's outing. We're just going to have it. I started cooking, weather concerns. So next Saturday, we're going to have the men's outing, you know. There's still a sign up back here, I believe, for it. If not, let us know. We want to make sure we've got enough men, boys, all of us. Hey, we want to go have a good time, you know, get out there and play around the water. And we got United Worship, round three, coming up, September 11th.
Amen.
7 o'clock. Invite people, get everybody. anybody can to come out, I tell you, there's just no doubt it's going to, you know, the Lord's going to keep doing bigger and better things. I believe that. Homecoming, the next day, Sunday, 9:12. Next Sunday, we got homecoming, so looking forward to that. All right, so we got CR tonight. We got a guest speaker, Josh. Maybe? No?
COVID disease on me. He won't be coming tonight. We've rescheduled this for precautionary measures, but we're looking for another speaker, or we'll do a lesson. We'll have a good time in the Lord, no matter what.
We will. God provide. There ain't no doubt. We've had it happen before. People cancel. God show up, give us something that we just what we needed that night, you know. So, you know, we just remember that family in prayer, Josh's family. Let's remember Teresa. She's not here with us today, so let's keep her. And everybody that's been affected with it, you know, we want to keep them all in our prayers, you know, and pray for them. We know the Lord's going to take care of them, watch over them. And there's a lot of prayer requests this morning for those, you know, some people that have been hurt and had some injuries and stuff, that the families in the church. Let's remember all of them as well. Lord knows who they are. So, we're getting ready to take up our morning worship. If everybody would, if you'll stand with me around the room, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Josh, would you care to help us this morning? That's all right, Josh. I'll get these two fellows right here. We got Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. Your God, we thank you for blessing us to be out, to be in your house, dear Lord, Father. And we just give you all the praise, dear Lord, Father, for everything that we have here, dear Lord. We thank you so much for what you've been doing in our lives, dear Lord, in the church and the community. And we ask, Father, that you just give us the strength and help us and lead us and guide us that we can continue to go out and do your will. And we pray, Lord, that wherever we're at in this life, dear Lord, whatever we're doing in our work, just anywhere we're at, Lord, we pray that we can just be a shining example for you, Lord. We pray, Lord, that people will see and they'll inquire, that they'll want to come and see, dear Lord, that they'll just want to come and be a part of this service, they'll want to come and be a part of this community, and they just want to be a child of yours. No matter where they're at, dear God, we just pray, Lord, that you lead us and guide us and give us strength that we can help others. We ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen.
Where the Spirit, where the feel calm. Prison shake at the sound Jesus made. Lives made whole. Hearts awake at the sound Jesus made. Chains will fall. Prison shake at the sound Jesus.
Let me tell you about my Jesus. All the wrong turns that Not only am I home today, but I get to share the stage with this God.
Yes. Yeah.
God is a restorer.
Yeah. Jesus said, believe on me,
believe on me,
get out of your belly,
get out of your belly.
lives for Jesus today. Come on now. You've been born again. Hallelujah. Anybody been born again tonight? Give him a praise. Woo! Jesus said it. I'm alive and I'm made free. Hallelujah. Give the worship team a hand this morning. Come on, give a hand. Do you appreciate them this morning?
We are very, very blessed today. What a wonderful anointing. They are talented. There's no doubt in my mind they're not talented. But they're anointed. Amen. This has got reverb on it. Take it off, folks. Amen. They are. Sound like we're in a hole. Amen.
Appreciate our worship team. I appreciate it. It's so good to have this. Sister Allison's on board with us, and we're gift her.
Yeah!
Yeah! She told me this morning, she said, I'm a little nervous, and I said, you're home.
Amen.
Yeah. There ain't no need to be nervous, and we love Sister Al. And we love her very much, and all these guys, I just appreciate them, our worship team, all of them, anyone that's ever, we just appreciate you today. Amen. I love you this morning. I appreciate you. If you have your Bibles, I want you to open them with me to the book of Revelations, chapter number 3. Revelations, chapter number 3. Amen. Isn't the Lord good?
Amen.
I said, isn't the Lord good?
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, that's right. He is good. We love you today. If you're here, if you're visiting with us at Whitley, we just appreciate you visiting here today. And I know we got a good crowd today. And if I don't get to see you before you leave, I thank you for being here today. I try to visit with folks when they come in. And if this is like your second time here, you're home. You're
Amen.
Home. Amen. And we have some folks that's wanting to join the church, and we're going to do that in service. If I don't forget, we're going to do that today. And it doesn't give you any more clout with God. It just gives you a voice and gives you a home. And we open the doors to everyone. We're just honored to be here. Amen. Revelation chapter 3. I'm going to take my time today, and I'll try to keep it brief as can. And I don't. Long-winded kills me sometimes, and I don't want to be one killing other people, so I'll be kind of brief. Well, I'll be anointed as best I can. How about that? Amen.
Amen.
Revelation chapter number 3. Go with me to verse number 1. If you found it, say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Verse number 1. And the word of the Lord says unto the angel of the church of Sardis. The angel says, write these things. These things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest. Listen to what the word says. You have a name that you are alive, but you are dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain. Oh, this is going to be good today. Strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember, therefore, that thou hast received. Somebody say, I've got it.
Amen.
Oh, that was weak. Say it again. I got it.
I got it.
Thou hast received and heard and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come unto thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I come upon thee. Turn around as you're sitting down this morning and tell your neighbor, I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss it. We live here in the Whitley City area, the region, in the McCurry County region. And when I say the region, that includes Scott County and Pulaski County and Wayne County and Whitley County, just the area that's around us, because we have folks from all over that come to church, and I'm honored that you're here. But we live in a region a lot of times, and there's some really, really good things about it. One good thing about it is we're kind of secluded. We're kind of off the beaten path, if you will. We don't have a lot of the things that you see in bigger cities. and we don't have the big shopping centers. We don't have the mega highway out here that's, you know, congested. And we're not Somerset. We don't have 452 traffic lights through the middle of town. And a lot of times we complain about that. A lot of times we'll complain and say, well, you know, we're just a little old town. But there are a lot of good things about being in a little town.
Amen.
Well, I know about everybody. Amen.
Amen.
I know a lot of people, and a lot of times it's like Brother Tony was talking at the opening of service. A lot of times I run into people, and I know I'm wonderful with faces, I'm terrible with names.
Amen.
And a lot of times I run into them, they're like, hey, Pastor Bruce. I'm like, hey, brother, hey, sister, how you doing? If I do that, I don't have a clue who you are. I'm sorry. I've had a brain malfunction at that particular time, and I forgot your name, but because I know a lot of people, but that's really not an excuse. But I'm getting old. How about that? I'm just getting old. And so we live in a small town, but one of the things, and a lot of times we don't, you know, unless we watch the news. I'll just be honest with you. I'm just going to be straight honest with you. Judge me. I don't care. I don't watch the news. I just don't watch it. I do read papers, and I read different things off different things, but I just don't, because the news is very one-sided either way. Okay, I miss the days, I was telling Brother Isaiah this week, I miss the days of Walter Cronkite when he just gave you the news and you took it for what it was.
Amen.
There wasn't an agenda, there wasn't something that they were trying to put. You just he trusted your intelligence to just read it or just receive it for what it was. And so we live in that area, but this is one thing that we do know, even though that we are living in a rural area, even though we're kind of, and there's great things about it, and I love it, and I wouldn't want to live in the city. I just don't want to do that. That's just me. And, you know, that's just me. But there's one thing about it. We know, all know that the Lord is coming back for everybody.
Amen.
Yeah.
Okay? And we also know this, that we are biblically based enough, we are biblically studied enough, and we do see the news. And I see some of the things that's going on in Afghanistan. And I don't know if you saw the news or saw the papers. And I saw just a print, just on a paper, I believe it was, a print of one of some of the people trying to climb on the plane that was leaving there, and the little circles around the people that was falling off, that was trying to get on the plane to get away from the area that they were in, trying to come to this area. And I looked at that and I thought, man, we are living in some really troubling times. We're living in, I turned 57 Monday, this past Monday. And so in my 57 years, I have seen some pretty troubling times. I've seen some recessions. I've never seen a depression, but I've seen some recessions. And I've seen a lot of civil unrest in those 57 years. I've seen some stuff, but we're living in some troubled times. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter number 3, starting at verse number 1, it says, "This know also that in the last days, perilous or dangerous times will come."
Yeah.
In the last days. Now, I want to tell you something. I'm not trying to scare you. I really want to excite you. We are living in the end time.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, my thought today is I don't want to miss this. I don't want to miss this. And so, we're living in the end time. We're living in the day that I believe there are those of us sitting in this room today, this morning, at Whitley City, at the hour of 11:55, according to that clock, that you are going to see the return of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And I don't know about you, but I'm excited about that. Come on. I'm excited. Now, I said that to say this. I said that to go here. The Bible tells us, and if I've had it texted to me once in the last little bit, I've had calls and texts and run into people, and they're always, you know, picking my brain, I guess, as a pastor, and I've been doing this for a long time, and they always want to ask me, when do you think the Lord is going to come? And I said, and my answer is simply one word, soon. We don't know the day or the hour. We know the season. We can look at the seasons. But we're looking at some of the things, young people, listen to this, Pastor, because this message is really for you today. And listen to me. We are living in the last time. The Bible said, in the last days, I will pour my spirit out upon all flesh.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm about to get excited.
Bless the Lord.
I'm trying to make this quick. In the last day, I will pour my spirit out upon all flesh. So as you look at the news, you see the things that's going on. You see even the things that's going on in our country and how the extreme liberal left, I guess it is. Now, I'm not trying to get political. I'm really not. But how that they want to take away the Word of God. They want to take Christ out of this. They want to take God. And there may be some of you this morning that know people, or maybe even had this mindset at one time, and God's kind of opened your eyes. But we're living in a time. The Bible says in the book of Revelations, as I've been reading some this week, and it gives seven churches. It's called the seven churches of Asia, or the seven end time churches, or the seven last day churches. And I'm just going to talk on one this morning for a few minutes. The scripture says in Revelation chapter number 3, the Spirit of the Lord comes, the Lord comes to John on the Isle of Patmos, and he said, I want you to write this to the church at Sardis. And I'm going to paraphrase it. He says, I want you to write, you look like you are alive, but you're dead.
Listen.
Oh, somebody look at your neighbor and say, I hope you're living.
Amen.
You look like you're alive, but you're dead. And I begin to think about that. I begin to think, how in the world can something look like it's alive, but it's dead? Well, I thought about that several times. This week, Brother Isaiah and I was down at the farm. We was working on the water line. He was actually digging, and I was watching. And I thought, well, while he's digging and watching, I'm going to go over. I'm going to feed my chickens and check my chickens out. So I start walking over toward the chickens, and I go over there and check them. I don't know. I got 25, 30, something like that. I don't know. I got a bunch of chickens in there. I was checking their water, and they had water. I was checking their feed, and they had feed. And I come back, and Isaiah's standing probably from here to the parking lot from me, and I'm walking across the grass and walking under the big old apple tree that's there, and all of a sudden I realized, because its head come up out of the grass, a copperhead about that long, and it was kind of curled up, and I screamed at the top of my lung, and I'm telling you right now, a 57-year-old man's got a 40-inch vertical when he's standing beside a copperhead. And I said, woo, copperhead. And Isaiah said, where? And I said, right over there somewhere. Because I had went from over there to over here in about a half a millisecond. You know, I look, and so I got a pistol out of my truck, and I walked over to the copperhead, and there it lay. And brother, Pastor Josh, I took the pistol and I shot the thing in the head. But I didn't know if he's dead because he looked alive. So I shot in the head again. And I didn't know if it was dead because it still looked alive. So I shot it in the head again. Come on now. I hate them Dutch. And Isaiah looked at me and says, is it dead? I said, I don't know. I see three bullet holes in its head. I see a little bit of blood. For you snake lovers, I'm sorry. Little blood trickling out of it. So then Isaiah takes a shovel and he cuts its head off. And he looks at me and he says, it's dead now. And I done the Holy Ghost dance right there. Ooh, see, sometimes we look alive, but really we are dead. I'm about to preach to you right now. Sometimes we look like that. We look like the church. We got the building, we got the people in the pews, we got the music, but are you alive today? Somebody help the pastor right here. Are you alive today? I don't want to miss it. The scripture says, he said, I got a little bit against you, Sardis, because you look like you're alive, but you really did. See, they were all about image. In this last day we're living in, we got preachers on television. They'll preach a message and they got thousands of people that follow. They write a lot of books, but they never mention the blood of Jesus Christ. They never mention sin or sin in the hell. They give you a field. I want to tell you today that you must be born again. Amen. You must have the blood of Christ upon you. You must take off the old coat and put on the new. There must be, oh, somebody help us. There must be a change. I like what Pastor Josh said. You can tell what's alive because it moves. It moves. Dead water looks alive, but it's stagnant. It stinks. And what makes it different from being alive water and stinking water is new water comes in and other water goes out. It's happening right here. We've got to have the Holy Ghost coming in, and we need the Spirit of God going out of us. We need the Spirit of God more today than we've ever needed.
Yeah.
See, there are some things in our lives that we can tell when we are alive. We can tell when there's been fresh anointing coming into our life. I don't know how you feel, but I don't want to miss this thing.
Amen.
Scripture tells us in the book of Matthew, or in the book of Luke, chapter number 19, gives us a story, and Jesus is coming off the Mount of Olives. And he's descending from the mountain. He's getting ready to go to Jerusalem. And Pastor Isaiah, he's on the outside of Jerusalem, and he's looking in. and he's looking on the inside of Jerusalem, just looking at the city, looking at it from afar. He's come off the mountain. He's come off the mountain. The Bible said when Jesus comes off the mountain, then his disciples begin to cry and they begin to shout. And there's some Pharisees that are around there, and they're standing around, and they tell Jesus, "You need to quieten down your disciples." And Jesus said, if they hold their peace, then these rocks will cry out in their place. I don't know how you feel, but I don't want a rock to take my place. I want to lift up my voice. I want to go up. I want to give a praise. I want to let the world know that He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is the rock of the world. He is the beginning and the end. He is my redeemer. He is my best friend. He's this close to the brother. I want the world to know.
Said our preacher's crazy. I'm crazy. I'm crazy about the Lord. The Bible says he comes off the mountain and he begins to the rocks that he tells them, he says, if they keep silent, the stones, they're gonna cry. And he's coming closer to the city. He's coming closer to Jerusalem. He's getting closer. The scripture says as he draws near, he saw the city. And Jesus began to cry. He began to weep. He began to weep for the city. Now listen to what the word says. And you can read it for yourself. It's in the book of Luke, chapter number 19. Jesus begins to weep over the city of Jerusalem. Now you will say, well, pastors, why is he weeping? This is why he was weeping. Scripture says he began to weep over the city. And he said, if you had only known.
Come on.
If you had only known, especially this day, how close I was and who I am, and what I'm about to do, you wouldn't have missed it.
Yeah. Come on.
Somebody help me right here now. If you had only known who I am and what I'm about to do, you wouldn't have missed it. I'm going to get straight with you this morning. I learned a long time ago, plain talk's easy to understand. There's some of you in here, you know about Jesus, but you don't know Jesus.
That's the Lord.
Come on now.
There's some of you listening to me today. You've had a relationship with the Lord in your life. You may have had a really good initial relationship with the Lord in your life, but you have allowed things to come into your life and has separated you, just like the church of Sardis. You've allowed things to come in. You look pretty good on the outside. You're not a bad person. I'm not saying you're this or that, but you don't have that walk with God. I'm telling you right now, as sure as I'm standing here today, as sure as I'm looking at you, and it's 12:04, in the afternoon, Jesus is coming, and He's coming after a church that is alive. Yeah. He does not want you to be born. He does not want somebody to help me right here. Yeah. He wants you to be alive. See, so often we can look the part. I'm gonna be honest with you today. There's been times in my ministry that I have, I don't want to say fake it, but I just, yeah, that might be, I just pushed through. I didn't feel it. Stuff I'd gone through, but I just kept holding on, and I just kept pushing, and I just kept doing it. And then all of a sudden, before I realized it or not, Brother Gary, the Lord showed up, and I found out that He was there the whole time. He never left me. He never was sitting here. He said, "I've been with you all the way, even under the hill." Jesus said, if you only knew, if you had only known that I was this close, I was so ready to give you peace, but you missed it.
Bless you, God.
You missed it.
Come on.
I don't want to miss it, folks. I don't want to miss it. I want an outpouring. See, when God begins to pour, do an outpouring on us, and He says He will in the last day, we will have a new visitation of His Spirit. I don't know how you feel today, but I believe Whitley City is right in the midst of a new visitation of the Spirit of God. And somebody help me out today. You are in the room. I don't want to miss it. If you're here today, if you need to give your heart to Christ, let this be the new day of your life.
Amen.
Yeah.
Come on.
You may be on the verge of making that commitment. You may be on the verge. I had a lady, I talked to her here a couple of weeks ago, and I didn't even know who she was, but she knew, she recognized me, and she said, "You've been talking to my son." And she said, "I want you to know that you're making a difference in his life, but because he's been calling me and telling me about Jesus. Yesterday, I got a text from a young man that I've been witnessing to, and that young man texted me, and he said, 'Bruce, I just want you to know, I want you to be praying for me, because I really feel there needs to be a change.'" See, there needs to be a change, but it takes you to make the change.
Amen.
I can't do it for you. You got to make the change. We need a new visitation of the Lord. When we get a new visitation, we receive a new power. The Bible says in Acts chapter number 1, verse 8, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you." When the Holy Ghost comes, I don't know about you, but I want some more power.
Yeah. Come on.
With that power, you get authority. You get authority. See, some people crave authority. I don't crave it. I'll be honest with you, I've been pastor here for a long time, but I have never craved being a pastor.
Bless you, Lord.
Never did. I saw what my dad dealt with as a pastor, and it wasn't difficult as far as hardships, but the responsibility of it. And I just didn't want that. But somehow God put me in that place, and I'm thankful that He did, because we've got a wonderful church.
Amen.
And I'm thankful for that. Been here for a long time. But He will give us new authority. When I say new authority, it says in the book of Luke chapter number 10, He said to them, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven, and behold," He says, "I will give you authority to trample upon the serpent," not the copperheads, amen, "and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you."
Amen.
We have authority. We as a body of Christ have been passive for way too long. You have authority. You have the authority over your life. You have the authority over the enemy. You can tell the enemy to get out of your house in the name of Jesus, and he's got to get out of your house. Amen. You can tell the enemy to get his hands off the lives of your children, and he's got to back off your children in Jesus' name. Somebody help the pastor right here. You tell the enemy to let go of your health and speak health into your body, and Jesus will give you health, and the enemy's got to let go because you have authority.
Yeah.
Young people, listen to me. God is wanting to raise up in this last day a new generation. Got the enemy trying to push everything in the world on our new generation. But I see a new generation sitting in here. And when I look downstairs this morning, Brother Sean's class, and I don't know, 25, 30 young people, I see a generation that's hungry for God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Oh. Come on. I 5 minutes, I'm done. I'm not talking about a generation that's just hungry to come to church.
Come on.
I'm not talking about a generation that just wants to be a part of a youth group so they can go to Dollywood. Or so we can go to Kentucky Kingdom, or so we can go to Lake on Saturday. But I'm talking about a generation that wants the power of God.
Amen.
Because this generation don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss it. Listen to me, young ladies, listen to me. You have authority in Christ's name. Young men, listen to me. You have authority. And more important than anything else going on in your life is your relationship with God.
Right.
Now, I ain't trying to burst no bubbles, but it's more important than that little girlfriend, or more important than that boyfriend.
Yeah, come on.
Treat them good, be kind to them. But it's more important. It's more important than the next ball game.
Amen.
Yeah.
It's more important than anything in your life is your relationship with God.
Amen.
Because he says to the church at Sardis, he said, "Listen to him." He said, You've known me. You've walked with me. You look alive, but you're dead." But listen, let me go back to that text, and I'm coming to a close. But listen to what he says in that text. He says, "But I want you to strengthen the things which remain."
Yes.
In other words, there's a little life left in you. There's a little something left in you. And it's time, as Paul told Timothy, to stir up the gift of God that is within you. I want you to stir it up this morning. I want you to leave here today knowing that if you're not born again, you can be born again today. Yeah, holy and different, you can be hot and hot. We're in the process of doing a new building, and you've got to jump through all these 455, 5,000 hoops to get to that process and submit applications and submit stuff to state. I'm not running a popularity contest, because those that know me know I don't care. You like me, hallelujah, that's good. If you don't, I'm not mad at you. I love you, I pray for you, it's fine. You don't have to like me, you don't have to like the way I preach, you don't have to like the way I do it. That's fine. We're cool. Everybody's different, right? Some of you like your steak well done burnt. I don't know what's wrong with you, but you bumped your head. Some of you like it the other way. I used to have a buddy who used to say, just run it by the stove for about 30 seconds before you bring it out here. And I always tell everybody, a good vet and some CPR and that thing live. I can't handle that. Somewhere about in the middle is where I like it. A little less than the middle is where I like it. That's what makes the world go. But I will tell you this. I do love you in Christ. I want you to go to heaven. I don't want you to miss it. Because there will come a time, and I believe it's coming really soon, it will be too late. Some of you sitting in this room, I just felt the Spirit of the Lord just hit me. Some of you in this room, there is an anointing in your life that you've been sitting down on the anointing. You've been holding back. You've not been stepping forward. There's an anointing to teach. There's an anointing in ministry. There's an anointing for all that's more than just preaching behind a pulpit or singing behind a piano. There's more things than that. But there is an anointing in your life. This whole message has come to this. And you're sitting on it. There's some of you sitting in this room today. There's a young man sitting in this room today. A young woman sitting in this room today. That God has called you. But you've been disappointed. You've been broken. You made mistakes. Said things you shouldn't say, done things you shouldn't do, been places you shouldn't be in. Listen to what I'm about to tell you. So what? We all have.
Yeah.
Ain't nobody perfect in this room. Nobody. I listened to a man speak yesterday that had a life sentence in prison. He'd served 42 years in prison. He still has murder charges on him. But somehow he gave his heart to Christ. And I mean, you can be around this fella 30 seconds and you can tell this dude is real. And the judge walked in, a federal judge walked in and said, I know you got 29 years left on your sentence. You do not get out till the year 2049. But I am going to give you a pardon. I'm going to release you. I'm going to let you go. And he wrote the pardon and he let this guy out of prison. Now, you might say, Pastor, what about that? Let me tell you, Jesus can set you free. I don't care if you're a federal fool. I don't care if you're a judge. You have to make an effort. Scripture says, he said, listen to me. Remember, therefore, thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. Strengthen the things which remain. Now listen to what his next word says. That are ready to die. What's that mean, Pastor? There are things in our life, spiritual things in our life, that the enemy wants to kill out. Some of you, and I feel the Spirit just pushing me this morning. There's some things in your life that are good things that are about to die, that you've got to revive. How do I revive it, Pastor? You feed it. You care for it. You push it. Stand with me today. Listen to this pastor. 2 more minutes.
I want you to hear me. Got a little louder so you would. Do not leave. this building without renewing your walk, without restoring your faith, without waking yourself up, because we don't want to miss it. I want to reiterate, it doesn't matter to me where you've been, what you've done, where you are. I don't care. I don't want to know. I don't care. That's in your past, and your past is done. You can't change it. I really can't do nothing about tomorrow. Jesus holds tomorrow. But today, I can make a decision. I'm going to be different. Oh, I feel the Spirit of the Lord. There's some young men in here. God's got you. He's ready to set you on fire. But you got to make a commitment. There's some young women in here that God's got an anointing in your life. He's got a talent in you. But you got to step forth. It's scary. I know it is. But you got to do it. There's some dads in here today. You're going to be the change of your life, of your family, and those around you. But you got to step forward. Church at Sardis is in danger of missing it. I don't want to be that. I don't want to be Jerusalem and have Jesus standing on the outside saying, man, if you only knew. There's some of you today that's in that position. He's standing at your door. He said, I want to come back in. I want to stir you up. This morning as they begin to sing, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. I know you're here, but I'm not going to come get you. That's not my job. Spirit of the Lord draws you. He's drawing you right now. And it's your job to take a step of faith. And let's come to this altar this morning. You're a person that needs to come to altar. You need to restore your life. You need to give your heart. You need to renew that walk with Christ. You don't want to miss it. There's some things that the Lord is anointing. That's it, Brother Tim. You got it, buddy. That man, God's got it for you, son. I want you to come right now. Come on, young man. Come.